right, thanks for tuning in. We are the Pixel Wankers. I'm Tim.
I'm Mitch.
Scott, you son of a bitch, you skipped me.
Yeah, he's not that cool.
I'm Crow, and he's just butthurt because Jessica Jones sucks.
Oh.
Again.
Sorry,
be careful,
like
he's British.
Yeah.
He's very persuasive.
Is that how it is?
Yeah. No, so he's the purple man?
Yeah.
No, I was going to start off. I was pretty excited over the weekend. I don't know how many of you guys are actually point-and-click adventure players, but I was a huge point-and-click adventure player, and they are remastering Day of the Tentacle, which is amazing. If you've never played Day of the Tentacle, it's an old LucasArts game, and it's a lot like Monkey Island or any of these things, and it's seriously one of the best things. What the hell's the matter with you? What are you laughing at?
I was waiting for Scott to make an Asian joke. Talking about tentacles.
It sounds like a fun game. I've never played it.
I've seen a lot about it. I've never played it, but I know a lot about it. I've seen a lot about it.
Yeah, it's essentially like the sequel to Maniac Mansion, which was, old school graphics. In fact, you can play Maniac Mansion in Day of the Tentacle. Like, you can go to this old computer in the game and play the other game.
Maniac Mansion, cool. I have heard of. I've never played it, but you can, put a hamster in a microwave.
Oh, yeah. And there's a hamster in this game as a throwback. Like, it's super funny.
I know these main plot points that you play hamsters in microwave.
Hamsters, tentacles,
there's the absurdity. Scott's here.
So, I'm really excited that they're remastering it. I'm on the fence because, as much as I love some of the recent games that Tim Schafer has done, he's not the best project manager or money manager. So, Broken Age, great, he kickstarted it, got a bunch of money. Mm-hmm. The game was actually not that bad, but it went way over budget. They had to go get more money for it, and it went way longer than it was supposed to. It's fine. This, they've just announced that they aren't asking for money, like it's just something they're doing in-house, so I'm stoked.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
Are you any of you guys fans of point and click? I remember Who Goose House of Horror. Yeah, remember that one?
No, all the games like that's probably the least popular.
I know.
Point and click game you could.
Yeah.
It was one of Midway's classics.
You're right. Yeah. Turok's point and click.
It was the only game that my dad had on his like PC on his like laptop when I
next to Jazz Jackrabbit.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And PowerPoint pictures.
Right.
I like the Sam and Max, I think they're really good.
I love Sam and
they're
Max.
They're really fun.
Did you ever play the remade ones?
Yeah.
Telltale did?
Those are the ones I played.
Oh, you never played the originals?
No,
I've
played
the
originals.
My God. Okay.
And then I also really like, I guess you could count The Walking Dead or Telltale stuff.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, they're essentially point-and-click adventure games. Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm a fan of those.
Nice.
Yeah, the Game of Thrones Telltale point-and-click is dope.
Yeah,
especially if you're a Game of Thrones fan. Holy God.
I'm not a Game of Thrones fan. Everyone here, I think.
Mitch? I'm kind of on the fence.
What?
You're not?
What?
They'll bring Buffy crossover eventually.
Then I'll tune in.
I only got Tim to watch like one episode. Maybe you watched 2 to 3.
No, you came over to my house and we had a full season and you watched it all like in a night, right? And you're like, this is the greatest show ever. And I watched an episode and that was it. And then like 3 years later, I caught up on 3 seasons.
Oh, okay.
Which is fine. And then I haven't watched any since then.
For me, I missed the boat. Everyone was like, oh my God, it's so amazing. And I don't have cable TV, so I was like, yeah, whatever.
Mm-hmm. You haven't missed the boat. I have the DVDs. You can borrow them.
Yeah, I might do that.
Me and my wife watched like the first three seasons in like a weekend.
Yeah.
And then we're like, we have to buy more. And it's like, oh, the fourth one's not out. It's like, damn it!
Yeah, dude, when you like run out of Game of Thrones to watch, you're like, son of a bitch. Because it's never like a good note that they end on. It's always like a cliffhanger.
Yeah. I really want to watch it. Like, it's really popular and there's nothing really stopping me. I've never had access to it and I've never really been bothered to go out and buy
it. Yeah, I hear it. That's kind of where I was at.
Real quick before we jump off the point and click adventure games, Telltale actually, Mitchell knows this, got the rights for
two new games.
Oh, I don't know the other one.
Yeah.
I'll tell the one, you tell the other. Yeah. One of them is a point-and-click adventure for Batman.
Really?
Yeah.
That's got the rights to it?
Yeah. They're doing a Telltale's Batman. It may not be.
Oh, Telltale's got it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I was like, Mitch bought the Batman.
Yeah.
Oh,
Batman. Batman.
Yeah, Mitch! Pixel Wankers is legit.
Yeah. So that's kind of cool. They're doing like a Telltale's inspired one. And I was telling Steve, I was like, they don't have to do Batman. They could do any one of the other characters in the...
Yeah.
In the series. Like, how cool would it be to play as Alfred?
Yeah.
Or Commissioner Gordon, you know?
Gordon especially.
Yeah.
Like, I would love Gordon.
Yeah, yeah.
Or if you're looking for a real short game, just play as Batman's parents.
Oh!
Zing!
Too soon. the other one they announced is Michonne. A Walking Dead spin-off of Michonne.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's her, like, Telltale's sort of rendition, which is kind of cool.
That's cool. Awesome.
Cool.
Yeah. In other news, what was it? Oh, Psychonauts 2.
Yeah.
Speaking of,
like, oh, really? They're doing the second one?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Psychonauts.
Well, so, that's great, but I am kind of on the fence because they made nothing back on Psychonauts. Like, was
yeah, but it's so great, though.
Sure, it's great, but here's the thing. You sell 100,000 copies of that game, doesn't even come close to what the money that they put into it.
No, I know.
Not even close. And so they're like, oh, we have these fans who think it's so great.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying it's not great because it was a good game, but it's it didn't go well enough to really make it worthwhile to do a second game.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
I know.
Kinda, but did like Ratchet and Clank do well enough to do movies and other games too? I mean, like,
surprisingly, they actually did really well and they have a great following.
Yeah. Ratchet and Clank?
Yeah.
I like the games. I think they're cool, mm-hmm. but like I don't know. I didn't know there was a huge thing. Like Psychonauts.
They're doing
actually,
a Ratchet and Clank movie.
I know. Well, that's what I'm saying. Is the following mm-hmm. big enough that that's? I mean, like, I can see Angry Birds because they just have a bunch of money to spend.
Angry
you know?
Birds was like the trailer was kind of surprisingly good. Like I thought it would be so bad. But like, I was like, oh, this isn't as bad as I thought.
Like I said, they have tons of money to spend. They just bought up a really good script and stuck Angry Birds in it.
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah, we can make these birds. Somebody make a bird joke, right? A bird
joke? They bought
joke?
The latest Batman script.
Yeah.
Stuck birds into it.
I'm Birdman.
But, I mean, Psychonauts 2, so what's happening with that?
So, I think Sony have just announced their version of Oculus Rift.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really? What's that?
It's their version of Oculus Rift.
It's not the Sony face.
I don't know.
Like, what's it called? You know,
it's just a pair of goggles you stick on your face. But so they've announced that, and I think that's their sort of headline game for it. It's Psychonauts 2, and they're also talking about something else.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Some other sort of mediocre games, but this seems to be like their real sort of heavy hitter. I think I don't know. It may just be a release.
Is Psychonauts a heavy hitter for like a
VR game
to jump off on?
I think
VR
it
game?
Is. Like, I can't remember the other lineup. But it didn't look good. Like, the other stuff was like, eh.
Well, and that's the thing. They may really be relying on the fan base that is, like, the extreme fan base, right?
Yeah.
They only sold 100,000 copies, but the people that really played it loved it. And they're going to be out there touting it, talking about it. So they may be relying on that as free advertising and them getting other people into it, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
Which is fine. For Call of Duty.
If they wanted to get people into it, yeah, they should have.
Well, first person that would get me to play a first person shooter. I'd shut up about it.
But here's the problem is like first person shooter in VR would be amazing, yet moving around is going to be very awkward unless you're actually moving. And they have
you've
devices
get that weird thing.
Yeah, that you can stand in and you're walking as the rollers all over.
I don't know if that's ever going to play out in a home.
Exactly, that's my point. So playing like a first person shooter in VR sitting on your couch, it doesn't give you like, oh, I'm going forward, you know, you don't have the same feel as if you're playing third person and you can look around and do stuff like that. Mm-hmm. That makes more sense jumping into it until you have the ability to physically move around in virtual reality world like
actually,
The Void.
That's another thing I was going to say. Speaking of VR, The Void's great, and I want to go a little more on that. But there was recently, this is a weird topic, but a Valvoline commercial. There was like a VR Valvoline thing. I don't know why they're like talking about VR, but it shows a guy get in a car, and he puts the helmet on, and then he's driving, and there's like a 3D version of his car near him and stuff. I'm like, that would probably be the coolest experience, actually driving a car with VR. That's probably the most dangerous experience driving in the VR, because you're literally driving blind. Unless they got the thing blocked out perfectly, mm-hmm. you're going to crash. But you're in a car, you're feeling the push and pull of the vehicle, you're actually driving the vehicle. It's not like when they have the steering wheels and they
you know what they probably did? They gave him a helmet that just had a cutout right here. They're like, virtual reality.
Well, this is like a real car.
Yeah. I'm not even sure what the commercial's for. It's like Valvoline, and then it shows like a guy who's like, VR, driving down the street, and then it's like, Valvoline, or, you know, whatever. I'm like, what the hell am I watching? Like, what is this?
I like that when you watch it, you're like, what the hell am I watching? And you're like, podcast material.
Well, it was just because I saw the VR. I thought the VR thing. Yeah. Like, it's really cool to bring VR into an actual thing where you're driving a physical vehicle that's actually putting the pedal to the metal. You're just seeing a really great, you know, scene inside of it.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool because that's as close to you're getting.
Do you know about the Void, what Tim was about to bring up?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. That's another really
should we
awesome
fill in the potential listeners on the Void?
Yeah. We can.
I also have a friend that's just done the beta.
Oh, so I really? Know
a bit about oh, really? It.
Yeah. Well, tell us what you know.
Well, we gotta explain.
I don't know
what
how
it
much
is.
I can.
Okay, so
this is a Facebook post, so I imagine that it's
if it's on Facebook,
open.
Say whatever you want about it.
Okay. Yeah. Well, apparently they attached a like a laptop to the backs.
Mm-hmm.
Because when it was plugged in, you could hear the Windows 10. Like, yeah.
Takes a lot of experience.
And they had an Oculus on their heads, and they would just walk around, and it had various rooms, and then it would open up into like a jungle sort of area. And they were able to like reach out and touch an actual wall. There was a physical wall there, but it looked textured. And then they had an alien fight at the end where you just had a fake gun, and you would just point and shoot.
Yeah. So quick summary to explain kind of what you were saying is. Mm-hmm. The Void is a physical warehouse that you can go into that they have physical walls built, and they've built a virtual world that when you put on your headset, you can walk around within this warehouse, and it projects a space station or whatever it is that you're playing onto these walls. So you can walk up and touch things, and it'll look like a digital panel, but you're just touching the wall. So it gives you this real experience. And there's actually a studio 20 feet away from us right now that are making levels to walk through in the Void.
And we should bring one of those guys in sometime.
We'd love to.
Podcast,
and I'm sure they'd be happy to come in. So, in fact, the Void, if anybody makes levels, is open to anybody submitting things right now.
Yeah.
So you can, if you do 3D stuff, do that. But they have really cool things. One of their things is a pretend elevator where you go onto the stand and it has bass speakers that kind of rumble that makes it feel like you're going up or down.
But you're just standing
there. Like, they have these really cool things that they make it feel like real world.
You know, I thought it would be cool. I don't know if they have this on there. But, like, imagine a level like Mirror's Edge where it's someone up on a building and you're standing on a scaffolding. But literally all they do is stick a 2x4 on the ground.
Yeah.
And you're walking on the 2x4, but you're looking like you're walking over a scaffolding over a building.
You get that physical sensation. Yeah. They may maybe have like fans like blow on you.
Well, I was going to say, they do have an edge in one of theirs where you walk to the edge of a cliff and it's just wind. And there is no edge of the cliff. Like, the actual video is a guy just standing in a hallway, but everyone's like, oh, like getting vertigo because of what they're experiencing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I saw this video from it, and it's like, this guy can see this torch over a wall, and he's next to the wall in real life, you know, and he like reaches up, and they've got a heater over there kicking out heat. So, you know, he sees the torch, and he feels like this heat. Mm-hmm. Can you imagine how like cool video games are gonna be?
Mm-hmm. Like, yeah, well, like,
if that really picks up.
Not only that, but your mind can, like, I wonder how people will feel in it, because your mind can like connect with things. Like, there's a experiment that they do on people where they give you a fake mannequin hand and they hide your hand behind a wall.
Yeah.
And then they touch the mannequin hand and your hand with a feather, and your brain links your hand is the mannequin hand because you saw the feather and you felt it.
Mm-hmm.
And then they smash it with a hammer. And you're like, everyone. And everyone freaks out, and they're like scared because they thought their hand just got crushed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so I wonder how it would really link up, especially if you're in there for hours. Imagine playing games for hours, and you're like, it's got to be so weird. I mean, I just took off like the little Google Cardboard after 10 minutes, and I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
A little wobbly, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I bet it's strange.
It's really cool to think where we'll be in 20 years, though.
Yeah.
Like, the type of gaming, we love games now.
Well, if this picks up, this is going to be like the new theater experience, right? This is the thing that you take your friends out to or a date to. You go and you have this multimedia experience where you get to go run through the forest or a space station shooting aliens with your friends for a night.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
It's no longer like, hey, let's go out
to the Laser Quest, guys. Yeah.
It's totally Laser Quest. Hey, let's go raid a dungeon.
Oh, but even better. Dungeons and Dragons in there?
Yeah. Imagine finding a real dragon. Like, the dragon is, like, coming at you, and you're, like, slicing its head off.
I saw this LARP video where they've got, like, this big trash bag dragon, and they put, like, a bunch of, like, little stickers or something on it, and you got to knock these stickers off to, like, take all of his HP down.
Fireball.
Well, okay, so let me ask you a question. What are the limitations to the void? Like, so in the commercial I saw on their website, mm-hmm. there's a guy, he's like in the Inception room, and he like punches the floor, and you see the floor go and bust apart. Do you think that they could do that?
No.
And so, have that work? Could I punch a wall and have it, like, that would be really cool if they had interactive destructiveness, you know, like the, it destroys the walls or pieces.
That's like, no, they're going to have something in the hand that's going to be the sensor. And it's going to have to be stuff that's going to... It's almost going to have this, some of the same like limitations as a video game. Mm. But in terms of, like, you know, if... Like, they're going to have to pre-program stuff. So you're not going to be able to just do whatever motion you want. And it's just going to pick you up and automatically program you to that game. So you're kind of going to be so stuck, I imagine, in, like, the genre of the game, right?
So it'll sense where your hands are. You've got sensors. You move around. You hold a gun. It shows the gun. When you look at it, you can look at your feet. I mean... All of that stuff is sensed.
I've always wanted to look at my feet.
Right? These are virtual reality. But it senses where you are and how you move, but you won't be able to destroy the environment. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, there may be things that you can topple over. There might be pillars that they set up that are just boxes or something you can topple over that have, you know, some sort of sensor so the texture is layered over the top of it. But for the most part, like, if you're an alien ship, they're going to make it so this is like a steel... siding, so even if you go up to it and touch it, there's no way you're going to break that anyways. Mm. You know,
let me ask you a question.
Okay, go ahead.
What do you think if, because I was just saying, like, oh, you look at your feet and that's a silly thing, but actually I was thinking, what if someone who was a pair, like, who didn't have feet
looked at their
was
feet?
was in a VR and they actually got to see their feet and, like, walking around, whether it's them, like, still in a chair moving around, but they could actually see themselves walking, or like someone without a hand could see a virtual hand, how would that experience go? You know, would they really feel like they have a real hand? Or because the articulation's not working, you'd still look like a mannequin hand. I'm just saying, like how what else could
Scott's
you do?
Scott's just like, oh my God. No, I'm sure, say if I lost my hand and I went in there and I saw something that was supposed to be attached, I might have the sensation for a minute, like, oh, God, my hand's back. But it's obviously not. You're not going to go interact with something and feel it and whatever, you know what I mean?
But it's a virtual game, so they could still...
They could use it.
If you moved your elbow close enough to something, they could still sense that as a proximity thing, and it would just pick up in your hand or whatever, you know? Like, I don't know. I think it would be, like, it's kind of an interesting idea, not just a game, but... Like Kinect. Like, Kinect is what it is, you know? Mm-hmm. But people use it for a lot more than just Kinect.
Oh, virtual reality is absolutely going to start being used in the medical field.
Yeah. Like, I can see Steve snicker. I'm like, trying to get you on the idea.
On the same page.
I'm not trying to be so crazy, but like...
No, you can't, dude.
Like, how could you see a movie in VR?
Well, like, a movie would be a whole other thing, because they have those 360 cameras, right, mm-hmm. that they are filming stuff with. So you can actually walk through a movie and look all around you to see all the other things that are going on, which is insane, because if you look at that from a standpoint of making a movie, you've got to hide stuff completely mm-hmm. from view, you know? And so you're walking as the camera, as the actor. Essentially, you're just a guy walking around, but you have to act out this whole scene, so when people watch it as you, as the main character, they can look all around you and find things and whatever, which is super cool.
It opens like a really cool like dynamic for like movies. Like, let's just say there's like an assassination movie, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, perhaps you can like spot that guy like long before he takes his shot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, well, here's the other thing, though. Like, I've done a couple of those 360 movies on my phone. Like,
mm-hmm.
they got like a Five Nights at Freddy's live action one, and they've also got
Ghost in the Shell.
Yeah, they're starting to do that. And,
oh, really?
And so I was like, oh, I'll give it a go. And I was like, this is kind of cool. But I found like I was often missing the action because I was so focused on, look at this. I was like, oh, something's happening. And I turned and I'm like, well, no, it's not there. Like, and by the time you get there, it's all happened. Like, you missed it.
Yeah.
I think here's the thing. This is what I've kind of been thinking for a little while is how does VR change making movies? Because when movies came out, like, you know, it's telling stories, you know, and then we could create movies, and we've created this shorthand of how to create movies. There's like, you know, there's books on storyboarding. There's books on, you know, screenplays and stuff and how to build a good movie.
Mm-hmm.
VR is going to be another step into a different realm of making movies.
It's going to be a different
movies.
Realm of
so
media.
You can't make a movie expecting that I can just put a 3D camera in the middle of it and everyone will pick up what I'm trying to do. No, you have to make that movie specific to the VR. So if it's a VR movie, it's set in one place or something, or a place that where someone can easily follow, or directed in a way that the audience
you
will still understand.
You know what would be really cool? Like a first attempt is, you guys remember that old movie, 12 Angry Men?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
just
yeah,
all
right.
In one room?
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
Yeah.
Because then you could just kind of like watch anywhere you're looking.
Something is happening.
Yeah, and it's all relevant. I mean, you're seeing like somebody's reaction to what somebody else is saying. I mean, now you could probably try and focus on what the one person's saying if you really want, whoever's talking, or you could just kind of move around.
Well, and that's the great idea. Like, if you redid a movie like that, 12 Angry Men, right? So there's certain times when the camera, it does go to other parts of the room where someone's like opening up a window and talking, or they're in the restroom washing their hands and
yeah.
they're like discussing what happens. The camera follows them because those are pivotal points, but what's happening in the room while the camera is in there?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that would bring the idea of doing a remake of a movie to another level, because you're remaking a movie, but you're also making the other thing.
You're adding
this
crazy dynamic.
That's going on.
Yeah, I don't think VR is going to be the media for film.
No.
The media
no,
for movies. The VR is going to be the media for experiences. It's
yeah.
it's not going to be mainstream. Hey, did you go see the new Marvel movie in VR? No, because you're never going to see the whole movie.
It's
going to
be somewhere in between video games and movies.
It is. In fact,
yeah.
I think it'd be an amazing educational tool. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Can
oh,
you imagine
sure.
in school being like, hey, today we're going to go see Lincoln's Address at whatever point.
Oh,
everybody put on your goggles.
Well, the movie Lincoln would be
right.
like
you know, or
cool.
hey, we're going to go check out dinosaurs. Everybody could put on, and
that's
this
exactly
is the dinosaur
right.
that did this. And I mean, to be able to go look at points in history would be huge
yeah.
educational tools, and you'd have people so much more interested in learning about things when they can actually see what's
and
going
experience.
On.
And would you have Carrie narrate it?
I would, and Blue Shorts Gus would show up.
Yeah.
And no one knows
talk
what we're
about
talking
about.
No
one
knows.
Jokes. I do think it's going to end up in theme parks, though.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Like,
yep.
that's, you know.
Yeah, I mean,
maybe
I think,
even
who do you think takes it on? Do you think like open? It's like just gonna be open to developers and developers.
No,
do
it's
it,
gonna
or?
Be Disneyland.
Disneyland
or whoever else.
Oh, yeah,
I mean, that's how they've done the 4D movies and stuff. You
yeah.
know, those
mm-hmm.
are have Moving been out for a while, and
yeah.
the studio themselves or the theme park themselves have had to develop the theater and everything inside
mm-hmm.
of it. And I think most of that stuff's pretty proprietary. I don't think
yeah.
it's really like out of the box. Just build a 4D cinema.
Yeah.
Well, I've got a good little segue right now.
Sure.
So Tim kindly donated his old Rock Band paraphernalia to me.
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
And so I've been hammering through Rock Band again. Not Rock Band, Guitar Hero.
Guitar Hero.
Yeah.
Mm.
And
yes.
it got me thinking, gaming peripherals, like how much they've changed, how much they've sort of come along in the last sort of 20,
it's
30
funny,
years.
It's funny because there's always been gaming peripherals. Even like there's old images that you can find of the NES, and it was like the NES quilting peripheral that never actually came out, but that's what they pitched.
Is that what do you mean by gaming peripherals?
Like just another
like,
thing that you can plug in. So like the power pad for Nintendo is a
yeah.
peripheral, right?
Yeah.
I had
the power glove
for...
is a peripheral. So
yeah,
like
yeah.
they came out with just ridiculous things like the quilting whatever it was for the Nintendo, because they knew it wouldn't sell, but that would allow them to pitch something for something else it would sell. But there are a bunch of crazy peripherals, because even with the Guitar Hero stuff, I have the keytar at my house.
Yeah.
Like, a
yeah.
keytar.
Yeah.
What the hell?
I know.
I'm waiting for Melodica Hero. For Theremin Hero. I have a Theremin.
I know, yeah.
I'm a weirdo.
Weird instruments.
But, I mean, it was funny, because we were going through, these guys were kind enough to come over and help me sort through a bunch of my games, and we're looking at just everything. I have Nintendo controllers that we still don't know what games they went to. There's these giant orbs that plug into your NES, and I have no idea.
Oh,
what.
The speed shot or something. What was it called?
No, I don't. They're like this big, and they have a giant ball on top and two big buttons.
Mitch coined the term robot tits.
Yeah, just about. That's what they are. And I have power pads.
Oh,
I have Virtual Boys. Like I have all these things, and it's just amazing. And of course, they've come out and. Now they have PlayStation Move, and the Kinect is an extra peripheral, and all these other things. But I don't know. It's become a whole other world. A whole other world.
Do you think you need the peripheral? Like look at a game like Frequency or Amplitude. Mm-hmm. Those were really great games. Those didn't have any extra add-ons. They were just
How old were those games?
2003 or something.
Okay, not that old.
They're making a new Amplitude.
What are you talking about?
You said 2003? Yeah. Dude, that's 12 years old. You say not that old?
That's not that old.
They're making a new Amplitude.
Some of our
game.
Listeners aren't born yet.
Should be good.
That's crazy. That's crazy.
Yeah, it's strange. Like, there's so many that have sort of come and gone. That, like, I guess the biggest one that sort of was fairly recent was when the Wii first came out.
Mm-hmm.
And all those really crappy add-ons for the
Wii
remotes.
We could just stick the remote inside of a gun casing and say that it's a gun. Yeah. What does it do? Nothing,
it's
really.
It's plastic.
Yeah.
We just make it.
Or, like, there was, like, a Wii Sports bundle, and it came with a tennis racket, a golf club.
Oh, yeah.
And all about this big, and it's like, what is
the point? The Wii Sports boxing gloves. You just put your controller in the glove, and you're holding it anyways.
I had one that's even stupider. It was, like, a Wii ripoff system, and it was, like, it didn't even work. Like, it didn't even have, like, the motion sensors, even though it told you to stick the remote in there.
Uh-huh.
But, like, you still use the controls and stuff.
You're just holding this big thing now.
It's like the stupidest thing ever created. But
it's so funny, depending on the day and, like, what episode you listen to, some days you guys are the best advocates for Nintendo, and some days you guys just shit all over them.
No, I love Nintendo, but they sell the most ridiculous things.
Like, it goes right back to, like, you know, old Game Boys, and they had the giant magnifying glass.
Oh, yeah.
Or the light in it, you know.
This screen's shitty and small. Here's a screen to make it a little less shitty
and
small.
Yeah, but it was, like, just come out like this.
I think it really goes back to the roots, though. Nintendo Game & Watch, you know?
Yeah.
The guy that created the Game & Watch created the Virtual Boy.
Yeah.
Right.
And are they that much different, really? I mean, not really. Like, the Virtual Boy is actually kind of a cool system, even though people give it grief. It does have some neat aspects to it.
Seizure and juicing.
I never
can
got
play
any
it when
seizures.
You come over to the house. Play tennis.
Dude, let's do it.
But, I mean, I think that it's just back into the roots that they've always been wanting to experiment with different technologies. In fact, I was listening. I'm just a weirdo.
You can't call those guns and boxing gloves different technologies. That's some stupid shit.
Well, trying to bring the game into the real world. They've always wanted to do something like the Wii.
Yeah.
And that's always been, like, their goal.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone knows them for Mario, everyone knows them for Zelda, but ultimately, you know, Nintendo's always wanted to do the Power Pad. They've always wanted to do the Super Scope. They've always wanted the Zapper Gun. All these things that, you know, they want to expand into the world because they want people to feel involved with the game. They want the story to be, you're in the story, you're doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it'll be interesting with all this VR stuff, whether they pick that up on the Nintendo NX.
I really wouldn't be surprised if they came out with their own version.
Yeah.
I really wouldn't. I mean, they're already doing stuff with the 3DS that has, you know, virtual reality things that you can play with the real world, you know, on a handheld device. I really think they're probably developing something.
Well, and from that article that we talked about a little while ago, a couple episodes ago, they said their demo models of the system used, like, cutting edge chips, you know, and computing power to actually get stuff. So they're going full bore. They're going to be, like, up there with the next gen.
Yeah.
Hopefully that it, you know, they don't take.
I just hope they try and get some titles. And I think we talked about this already. I just hope they get some titles to where it, like, makes me want to buy their console.
Mm.
Like, I'm tempted to get a Wii U. Solely because I want to play Darksiders 2 on it, because I guess it's got some cool stuff that they did, just like getting into your inventory and still like seeing your stuff. And then that new Zelda. But aside from that, or wait, is that like a different Wii U? Is Wii U the newest one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so it'd be Wii
but,
U.
But the new Zelda, they're thinking might come out.
They pushed it back.
They pushed it back.
I saw like an article like that they will make sure it comes to Wii U.
Awesome.
Like a week ago I saw that.
Well, but is it going to be like Twilight Princess with GameCube?
Probably.
You know.
You always find that with a new release, like...
Yeah, you might as well have it on both.
Yeah. I bought Hitman Blood Money on PS2,
and then it
was on, like, the 360 next week, and I was like, ugh.
Yeah.
My PS2 was screaming when I was trying to run it.
And we've gone over, like, the goods and bads of the GTA 5, you know?
Yeah,
it's
what
the heck?
Yeah.
But no, I sort of back to our sort of weird and wonderful history of games, like, there's been some crazy ideas when it comes to like add-ons for
consoles.
That's
some of the things that like I miss about older day, like older games, you know, is like it wasn't as expensive to make a game. So you would get like crazier stuff. Mm-hmm. You got like a lot more games that were just like utter crap.
Mm-hmm.
But there were a lot of games that would kind of like rise up out of that. Like, so you got like a good amount of games. And yeah, some of them were like you're rolling the dice, but at least there was a good variety.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to now, it's like you've got like two different brands of shooters.
Yeah.
Call of Duty and Battlefield.
You got your you got your heavy hitters, but I mean, that's if you're not looking into the indie scene, you know.
Yeah.
Because the indie scene's a lot like
what
you're
strong.
Saying, you know, before is it is cheap to make a game now with a couple dudes. And there's a lot of things that come out that are actually really decent.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if these games were made by Nintendo. I think that they were, but two games that were really odd but were cool experiences. First one was that Pac-Man game where you draw Pac-Man, and then he becomes Pac-Man. Do you remember that? It was on the DS. It was like an earlier launch title. And you could just draw Pac-Man however you want. And as long as he has, like, you know, kind of a point that goes in like a mouth and then a circled back, it turns it into a Pac-Man that can... You can control around the
That's
screen,
cool.
which was way weird and funky. It's
yeah.
kind of a weird idea. But I'm glad that they made it into a game, you know, because it's just, it took that to the next level to go, oh, what else can we do with this? And then they made, you know, like the yarn stuff for Kirby and stuff.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like, I think, the predecessor to that kind of game. And then there's like Electroplankton. Did you guys ever play that?
No.
Electroplankton was a game on the DS.
Scott
which was
plays
this...
all the games nobody else has like heard of.
Because everybody else sees it and it's like, what is this?
Scott's
shit?
Like, hell
Max?
Yeah, Electroplankton.
No, you guys gotta look up Electroplankton. It's cool. It's these little like fish, and so they're all over the screen, and they all make different musical instruments, and you can make musical instruments out of all these plankton in the ocean, and you make ambient noise.
Oh, yeah, I think I remember.
It was
that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Midway's killing it.
It was cool. So,
like,
what we're talking
my
about
fashion
was,
designer is one of the best. Best games in the DS.
We're talking about, I didn't say it's the greatest game or anything, but like it's these obscure titles that they experimented with. They were like,
yeah.
like Fill the Magic or whatever. You remember that game? Oh, don't tell me you didn't play Fill the Magic.
Wii Music is the future of like.
This sounds
orchestra.
Like a rape game.
Oh, Fill the Magic was Fill a little bit actually. You're this guy. You're dating a girl, right? And it's on the DS, and you basically have to like. She has scorpions like crawling on her back, and you have to like knock them off with the thing. Like, but
you're
dating
about,
her.
You're talking about like, oh, what's it called?
It's called Fill the Magic.
No. It's something else in Europe. It was called something. I've gotten.
And you have like she's on a boat, and you have to blow
her.
Like to get her across a lake.
It was called like
you do what to her?
Rub something. It was like rub rabbits.
Some asshole
rubbing,
like guys making a game is like we're gonna make them blow on their screen.
We
got a bunch of people at home like,
we grind you a let's play of Fill the Magic because you guys will crack up.
It I've already
like
played
such
it,
a creeper game.
Yeah, I've definitely played it. Now that you talk about that.
Your girlfriend's on a boat and you just like blow her.
What
kind of girls are you dating?
You blow the sail and it goes across the
ocean.
Okay.
See, that's a very different than
yeah,
you got a
yeah.
blower.
Well, that's the advanced stage.
This is the prequel to Honey Pop.
Yeah.
But I mean, so obscure game or game. Add-on.
Mm-hmm.
What would you guys say?
The Guitar Hero for the Nintendo DS.
I like that. How about
you
it's
like
kind of
it?
Fun. It's kind of fun.
Dude. Yeah,
it's
okay.
It's fun
I have,
like a song
I have
too.
That.
I could play
yeah.
it for hours. I mean, it would be awful.
What's the question?
What peripheral, obscure peripheral, did you like?
Oh,
obscure
I don't,
game for
I didn't have like crap for peripherals. I've never, like, I've had Guitar Hero and then I've had Disney Infinity's Pad. Aside from that, I've never been like, man, I need that extra piece. Oh, wait, no, I had those guns.
G-Cons?
We played that one.
We used to play Virtual Cop. We used to play...
The zombie one.
Mm-hmm.
House of the Dead. Yeah, we played that
on
one.
On the PS2?
You guys never played
PS2 or Xbox? I can't remember.
Yeah, so I had a gun that had all the little connectors on the end. You could plug it into whatever system.
Oh, nice.
So, yeah, we played a bunch of shooters, and those were fun.
Mm-hmm.
I really like doing fun
You guys
stuff
never played
like
Typing
that.
Of the Dead, where you have to type to battle the zombies?
So after you guys left, I found this old TI-99 at my house, and guess what game was inside of it?
What?
House, like, accounting management.
Oh.
Oh, yeah.
So now Tim
we're
can finally get
that.
Done with all those taxes.
Yeah, right. Like, thank
That's
you,
awesome.
T-99.
Yeah, G-Cons are awesome. Those G-Con guns.
Mm-hmm.
I love them.
Yeah, they were really cool.
Yeah,
so
we had some fun with that.
I really liked my Super Scope, even though there are only like three games you could ever play with the Super Scope.
Is it like the rifle?
Yeah, that's the big rifle.
What was your favorite game on it?
There's one where there's a bunch of bugs on the screen.
Yeah, that was the coolest. And splatted
the bugs.
Yeah.
And the cool thing was, like, that actually kind of worked, right? But the power glove, it never actually kind of worked because you had the bars you have to sit on your screen and you're like, well, okay, you can't play a game.
Watched a documentary like a couple days ago on power glove, and the guy who invented it went like full bore on that. Like Nintendo didn't invent that. It was some guy who's super passionate about like creating a glove or some type of manipulation that you could do for a screen with a hand, and he had it like really well made, but it cost like
a lot,
three times the amount. And they're like, you need to bring it down if you want to sell Nintendo stuff. So he had to make the cruddy one that you got, and then none of the games supported it. Like, there's the guy who was making the games was like, this is the stupid, like, when he saw it, the guy who was supposed to program the games for it, he's like, this is the stupidest thing I've ever seen in my entire life, and it will never go anywhere. And then they're like, okay, now you program all the games, and he's just like, oh god. And like, so it was destined to fail after all these like different iterations, but it did have a cool, like, really actual functional version that was expensive.
So bad.
Well, seems like we hit a little bit of a lull. You guys okay with me going into another game?
Yeah,
a little bit of game news.
Yeah,
me and you talked about it a little bit.
Yeah.
The Witcher 3 won Game of the Year.
Yeah.
Mm.
And I haven't beaten it, so this could be premature. It could turn into the Game of the Year thing, but I'm probably about 25 hours into the game, and it's not a Game of the Year. It's just...
You're saying they were paid off?
Yeah. That's exactly what I'm saying. No, it's... from what
you
I
really
saw...
You really don't like Witcher 3?
No, I actually do like it. I think that when it's great, it's great. It's, like, top of the line. It's awesome. Like, but when it's bad, it's really bad. Like, and I didn't know that there was, like, a bunch of, like, love around this whole unicorn sex scene. But...
What?
Yeah, that's right. Oh wait, hold on. I can't spot this. So a couple has sex on top of a stuffed unicorn.
Okay.
So, but supposedly Mitch was saying that that's like getting all this like buzz where it's like, oh, like this is like just to show like how great their love is or something.
On a unicorn.
It's just like stupid bonehead fans being like, oh my god, that's so awesome. Like, yeah,
it's not
totally sick. And it's just like, oh, shut off.
It's like, there's really great chemistry between these two characters. But then they're like after years of like wanting to get back with this girl, he's like finally going to get with her again, you know? And she like, he like looks over and he's like, oh, come on. And she like hops up on the unicorn. He like climbs up. And it's like, really? Like,
in the middle of that game?
Yeah. Dude, they are not shy about nudity. There was one point where I like walked around this corner, which it also has really bad level design too. They're like telling you to investigate like this like estate or whatever, and so you're like walking over through these houses and you're like looking at them and it's like, okay, well I can't find this guy. All the other doors are locked. Well, there's this stairway in this room on the far side, but it's not easily visible and it's dark like inside this room, so you don't see the stairs like right off the bat unless you're really looking for them. So I missed the stairs three times. I had to go watch a video, and it's just stairs. Like, this isn't a puzzle. It's fucking stairs. Like, put a light on the other side of the room that says, hey, stairs. It seems like that's just standard.
But do you want to be like that game where it's, like, in the dark, you're, like, looking through the whole dark, and it's just, like, a glowing staircase? Like, literally, the stairs are just, like, glowing. Like,
this is
walk
where you
up
walk.
These. Yeah. It's like, okay.
It seems like video games nowadays, and that's one of the things that people don't realize, is how intelligent they are about getting you to go where they want you to.
Mm-hmm.
It's like some lights, a sound, you know, they just funnel you where they want you to. And it's like, with this quest, it wouldn't have been hard to put some candles. It wouldn't have been hard to just have some light, like, breaking through a window or something. I don't know, but... Just
anything to show something was
there.
Yeah, don't make it like, oh, really hard. Anyway, so I get up these stairs. There's a girl who's got her hand stabbed into the walls, and she's not naked, but I walk into a room, and there's three naked girls inside of, like, a hot tub, or just a tub, and then
you're saying I'm a weird guy? Like, what the heck?
It's the Witcher game. Man. Yeah, I didn't make it. And this is what got Game of the Year. This is the thing that trips me out. And there's, like, a girl hanging, and, like, her boobs are out. And Andrea is on the couch, and she like wakes up. She's like, "What are you playing?" Like, it's The Witcher. This is weird.
Yeah.
But
Murder Simulator 3000.
Yeah. All I really wanted to say from what I've gotten so far is like, I would have been happier if Fallout 4 got it, and I didn't play Fallout 4. But Fallout 4, I guarantee you, doesn't name some of their characters Dandelion, Dodo, and just stupid bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. Anybody who thinks that that is, like got a better world development than, like, Dragon Age or Mass Effect,
mm-hmm.
fucking stupid. I'm sorry. There's no like nice way around it. You're stupid, or you're just looking at it with goggles that you love it, and that's okay to be like, look, I love this thing, and you really
goggles.
Like, yeah, like, because yeah. Dragon Age is my favorite thing, like my favorite game of all time, and guess what? Mass Effect is better. That's just me being real and understanding what I got. Like,
well, let me bring up a couple other game news. I threw them up on Facebook the other day. Was the one where the guy who directed.
Hideo Kojima.
Yeah. What the fuck?
That Fallout.
Pardon my French.
Like, I didn't know you're so fluent.
That Fallout has been going on for a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know the whole PT thing sucks. That like him and Del Toro were doing Silent Hill, mm-hmm. and that was like way cool.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that it's like scrapped or whatever, yeah. like, and then is Konami like. Akuza or something like yeah, can they just take care of you if you go out of line?
I think they're going under. They're starting to license their properties out to other people now. They're starting to focus on like mobile gaming. They're starting to do just really stupid decisions, and I don't understand it.
Well, they do like slot machines or something. That's where their main amount of money comes in. But yeah, it seems like they've just kind of like said like fuck you to games now.
I've heard that like there's like lead engineers who like. Were working on games and they have like an awful area that they work in, and so a lot of people have been leaving the studio. One guy left the studio and posted on Facebook, and this engineer guy liked the post, and then they told him, because he's under contract, you can't just leave, you have to like be out of your contract or whatever there, and so instead of being an engineer, now you're a janitor in the gym for liking a post on Facebook.
That's crazy.
Like, what the heck?
Yeah, Konami just went crazy.
Yeah.
Like, the fact that they would bar him from going, for one, it says they got some shit that they don't want him to say.
Yeah.
Well, I can't believe they would do that to the gaming community, because, like, shout out gaming community, like, they're not the kind of people that just sit still. If they know that, like, someone is being a total dick, they're not going to, like, play Konami games. Like, I don't know. I think twice that's about playing problem, another though. Konami game about that.
That's the biggest problem. That shit didn't hurt Metal Gear Solid 5 sales at all.
Yeah.
Metal Gear Solid 5 has been... I'm surprised that didn't win. It's been getting tens all over the place.
Yeah.
But it didn't hurt those sales. That game has done phenomenally as far as I understand. And, you know, if people would have backed it with their money, if they would have been like, fuck you, I'll buy it used, because that's what I'm going to do. They're not going to get my money, like, right off the bat. Like, mm-hmm. I'll give it to GameStop. But if people would have done that, then Konami might have, like, been like, well, we don't... Like, we should play nicer than that. But they're not going to, because everybody went and bought it. And people don't realize that when they, like... If you don't like something, like everybody flips out when there's like some sexual girl on like a comic book cover and they're like, oh, this is terrible. You're victimizing Batgirl. Well, don't buy it, jackass. Like, you don't have to.
Just read it in the store. Still from the comp guy. No.
No. It's just people are so professionally offended by everything nowadays.
Yeah.
And it's just like, give me a break. Like, why are you not offended that somebody's starving to death over in Africa, you little asshole? You're worried that a fictional character has some blood drawn across her face because the Joker's like a homicidal maniac?
Yeah.
You're
starving
an asshole.
Children don't get 100 likes on Facebook. You see.
Well, and then another news, too, the other video I posted about the guy who won the reviewer of the year or journalist
that was cool
of the
too.
Year. Mm-hmm. And he actually, like... thanked everyone in the industry who's working on stuff. Like, that was cool. That's really awesome that people have that ideal to, like, be like, yeah, it's not just a big corporate rat race. People are doing this as a passion. And to understand that, like, someone actually shout that out at, like, the biggest game, you know, awards. Like, I know that it's still kind of underground because, like, not everyone's a gamer. It's not on, like, NBC or something.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like, it's not Miss America.
It used to be on Spike, though.
Yeah. But, you know, that would be really... That's really cool that he had the audacity to be like, yeah, I'm going to go up there and I'm going to thank this chick who did level design for a game for Tomb Raider that I just thought was a cool level.
Yeah.
Or everyone who was working on these games. That's awesome. I think that's like...
Tear to my eye. How all. Right now, there's an artist on Maya busting his ass who's not going to see this video until it's in his feed tomorrow. Thank him.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Yeah. I was like, oh.
Me?
I think that like we get that a little bit more is because we're not in like a glorious like job, you know, like animation and just art pursuits in general. Like nobody like it's like he's the shit except for other artists, and it's like even then we just get shit on by people, you know.
Well,
do this for exposure.
Yeah. Well, speaking of animators that are coming back to stuff too, Don Bluth, the other post I was posting with the new Dragon's Lair.
Did we talk about this on here at all? Because I have a few things to say about that.
Dragon's Lair?
Yeah.
Yeah?
And Don Bluth.
Okay.
Let her rip. Tim sounds pissed.
No. He's 80, keep in mind.
Listen, Don. No, Don, he's actually, he lived around here in Sugar House.
I live in his house. No.
Still? Don, look in your basement.
He keeps asking me what I'm doing in his underwear drawer.
So here is my biggest issue is he did his Kickstarter, right? And he's asking for $550,000 to do his stuff. And that
to
is,
do Dragon Lair,
to do
the
Dragon's
movie.
Lair, to do a pitch of Dragon's Lair, the movie,
yeah.
To be able to do it. Which is fine. I think that's perfectly fine. It's good. You guys are playing footsie, and this is beautiful. I kind of want to just pay attention to both of you smiling.
Yeah.
So we asked this amount of money, which means that he's projected this is what it's going to cost to do all this stuff, and it failed. And so what happened is he took his campaign to Indiegogo, which no matter if you fail or not, you just get the money people pledge.
Yeah.
And he halved it to $250,000, yet didn't cut anything out of what he was gonna do.
Hmm.
So you budgeted for $550,000.
Yeah.
Just took out $250,000 and said, oh, I'll do the exact same thing for half of what I asked for. What? Like, what the hell are you thinking? From somebody that does budgets, from somebody that breaks down stuff, like, that blew my mind.
Yeah, how can you possibly half
it? How could you possibly half it, and how could you possibly offer the exact same stuff for that?
Well,
so from what he's offering, since you do budget and stuff, like, have you like tried to itemize it and break it down the way that you would? Was he charging too much before?
He's still charging too much.
You think he's charging too much
for what he's offering?
Well, what is he offering? So give us the list of.
So
what's
from what he's offering, from what I've seen, I think it's like 2 minutes of traditional animation for it to pitch the full movie, and that's all that it is.
2 minutes? That's
and traditional animation does take a lot more time.
Yeah.
And the talent that you're going to put on it, I get. It's not going to cost $250,000.
No. Well, Sean Thomas was doing a 10-minute animation.
Mm-hmm.
And he got guys like Joe Mad and then, of course, him. Well, and he's got like a whole studio behind him. And he asked for like 150.
But his
and
name is not Don
yeah,
Bluth.
Yeah, I would say, well, Don Bluth is the shit. It's been around forever.
But here's the thing. It's fine. Everything. It's fine that he's the shit, but that doesn't constitute saying, I'm the shit. You need to pay me 20 times more.
No, but Drew Struzan does the same thing with his posters.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, it's fine, but he's not on Kickstarter right now asking for 20 times the amount that he'd really need to do it. And then halving it.
I agree, but being an animator and a passionate animator, loving traditional animation, I just want to see it happen.
I would love to see it. I'm just Dragon's Lair. I love Don Bluth. But I'm saying, I don't think he's running his campaigns, for one. I think somebody else is behind it. The dude is 80. He doesn't understand this.
Yeah.
He doesn't. He has somebody saying, we can get money for this. We're going to ask for $500,000. And Don's going, that sounds good.
What do you think?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
With you, I think it's a bit too much.
Yeah.
For just
you don't want to see Dragon's Lair?
That's not the question. I'm saying,
yeah.
I want to see it. I'm just saying he's gouging people for it. Yeah. Whoever's running it is gouging people for it. And if that's really what he needed, he should have been asking for what he needed to make
from the
it
beginning.
Happen.
Scott's
and
just
not
and
here's
asking
the, here's the thing.
Well, I wonder if the scope did change at all. I'm not familiar with
the
projects that closely to know which ones.
I guess you don't want to see it happen then.
Well, I do want to see it happen. I posted it on Facebook. so that means I wanted to see it. Even though I haven't put any money on it.
10 seconds.
Yeah.
What were you going to say, Mitch?
The other thing is like, how much is he actually going to contribute? Is he going to dip his hands in, or is he actually just going to be like
overseeing? Was he just on the video saying, we're going to do it?
I would hope that he would be like laying down the keys in the storyboards and like
hope.
Doing this animation supervising and directing.
He's and ADD. Obviously in betweening, and he'd have other animation supervisors who would be supervising other side shots. But I would hope that he'd be doing the majority of it. You think? No. I mean,
he's 80.
Well, it's a lot of work.
So who cares if he's 80? Who cares if he's 80? No, Hayao Miyazaki is like 80 years old too, and he storyboards all his movies.
That's true.
Hayao Miyazaki is 82, and he storyboards all his movies. Don't tell me you don't know who Hayao Miyazaki is.
What did he done?
Spirited Away.
Studio Ghibli.
Oh my god. Wait, you know
or
what?
Or Totoro, or Howl's Moon Castle, or Ponyo, or.
I've seen.
Ponyo.
What ones have I seen? I'm thinking of Miyazaki.
Yeah, that's him. That's what we're talking about.
Hayao Miyazaki.
Oh.
Well, I'm thinking of Miyazaki. I don't know who you're thinking of.
No, I was thinking of Princess Mononoke, and when I grew up, I was like, this show's stupid. But then I saw it a little while ago, and I was like,
yeah, that movie's awesome.
Yeah,
like,
so I'm going to give his stuff a second try.
And he storyboards the entire movie himself. He does so much work. That guy is like
you
over
cannot
every
compare
single thing.
Anybody to Asians. They just produce different. It's legit.
I don't know. I mean, when it comes to animation
at our animation,
I'm passionate about it. I mean, like I really feel like this is where that guy's speech is going to. It's like, you know, people put so much into this. You know, like, we invest so much time to try and figure out how to animate something, and then everyone else just looks at it like, oh, you get to draw cartoons? You must be really, like, love your job. It's like, you're freaking kidding me? It's a passion. It's so hard to do animation.
Yeah.
Like, are you kidding me? Like, this is an art form. This is, like, the hardest art form.
Yeah.
And
it's so looked down on. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, it's like, people look at, like, a sculptor or a painter who throws some stuff together, and yes, sometimes it's well thought out, but there are a lot of painters that aren't doing it well thought out and making a lot of money, making a lot of recognition, and almost no animators get any recognition. Some big ones, you know, Glenn Keane, you know, Milk Call, you know, there's the Nine-O Men and all them. Great, but it really is.
Real quick,
everyone else sees it.
Who's that artist that's online that does like all the stick figures with like these super absurd shit?
Don Hertzfeld?
No, he's got like some internet name, but his stuff is garbage. But he's got like some funny jokes and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He'll charge like $50 for a commission, and it'll just be like this awful shit. And it's one of the things that drives me the most nuts. It's one of the things that helped me, especially getting into like comic conventions, because like the standard people like don't know what like good art is and what bad art is. But this guy has got like this line. He's fucking killing it. And then you look at like really talented artists, and they've got nobody. And I think it kind of speaks to what you're saying. Is like, you know, you want like the people who are like in the trenches, like learning the craft to do well.
Because
there's people who just do bullshit.
Especially in the U.S. Like not to down the U.S. It's great. It's fun. I love living here. It's an awesome place.
Yeah, you sound like it, dude.
But the thing is, like other places in the world see animation as more of an art form.
Yeah,
and we see it as just cartoons. And even people go, oh, it's just Bugs Bunny. Are you freaking kidding me? Bugs Bunny is awesome. Like, there is, like, so much that goes into that,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I get passionate about that. Sorry.
It's one hell of a soapbox you're standing on there.
Let me sit back in my chair.
Yeah.
No, long and short, I do love Dragon Slayer. I do want to see it, but I don't think Don Bluth is going to be putting his hand into everything like he might think he is going to, and I think that he is not running his crowdfunding campaign, and whoever is a dumbass.
Yeah, they're probably asking, I know they're asking too much. I know how much it's going to cost and how much
I know
really
you do.
Is.
That's why I'm looking at you going, seriously, you're cool with that?
But I just, you know, I guess I put my heart into it.
If you
want to
see
it
happen,
you know?
So bad, then you should want to see him put, like, a reasonable goal to it. If he's like overshooting it that far, you should be able to say like, that's some bullshit, right?
And he is an old guy. I mean, I don't know how much he has to retire on. Maybe some of this is like,
he's 80. He doesn't need that much.
Oh, you kidding me? He needs his gold toilet paper, bitch.
Exactly.
They're just animation cells. This is from
like, old Disney.
Yeah, straight Disney up stuff. Disney.
Thanks, Don.
All right.
We're getting close to the end. You guys have any closing thoughts?
PlayStation just announced a deck of cards.
A deck of cards.
Oh my god. People have shut off. Do we have anything else? Well,
yeah.
PlayStation just announced their deck of cards. Are you kidding me? Deck of cards.
What else is there? No, they're augmented reality ones. You use them with the virtual reality thing.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so that makes
sense. Oh, well, now you're interested, yeah. No, so, I won't tell you anymore.
How does
don't
this magic work? People are like, these guys are just laughing fools. So they're augmented reality. They have a little something in the back that you can take a picture of it and check it out on your phone.
Are they for the phone, though? Because PlayStation doesn't have any.
No, it's, I think it's for the VR stuff that we've just
announced. Okay.
I don't know. There's a whole bunch of stories. I was just like, oh, there's one we haven't Don't worry about it. There's nothing else. Nothing else has happened in the world for the last week apart from that deck of cards. But it's okay because we've covered it now. So we
have to watch like they come out and everyone's like, these are the best things ever. Pokemon, F you. These are awesome.
Yeah, but you wish you had me talk about those deck of cards now.
I wish that was their big announcement. Sony's moving into playing cards.
Some guy just walks out on stage and he just goes, just like shoots him out.
But there's nothing except for the one guy with the VR. He's all, oh.
If you looked at this VR, you'd be seeing some amazing stuff happening. But right now,
forget about it.
Oh, you know what? I know we're getting really, really low on time, but real quick, over the weekend they announced, or they finally showed some gameplay from Final Fantasy VII's Remake.
Oh, yeah, I was going to post that online, too.
I can't believe we totally almost skipped over that. It's exactly what I was saying it was going to be. It was, well, not exactly.
Yeah.
I thought it was going to play like Kingdom Hearts, for one, Tetsuya Nomura's the director. Yeah, it's going to. Well, Tetsuya Nomura, he's been the guy directing Final Fantasy. He did all the Kingdom Hearts. He did Final Fantasy XV, which is still being made, but he kind of set up the groundwork, and that plays very Kingdom Heartsy. And then, of course, there's this. But the really interesting thing that came out is that there's actually going to be, it's going to be episodic. You're not going to get it all in one game.
Oh, really?
Wow, no turn based as well.
Yeah.
They're just going to take the discs and they're going to give you each one.
Well, think about how long those games were.
That's the deck of cards. Yeah.
Well, okay, so here's the things. When I saw the gameplay, I was like, wow, that's amazing. And my friends were like, oh, but they're going like third person behind the guy behind, you know, the shoulder camera. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was like, yeah, I kind of expected they'd do something like that. Because, I mean, how else are they going to do? Like, you want it to be back to like the traditional map painted, you know, far out, like you're like 30 feet above them and you're just walking around a town. Like, we've grown from there. We have the technology to make something better. That aside, the gameplay felt a little, you know, Kingdom Hearts, obviously, kind of Devil May Cry-ish, you know, jumping in and slashing everything. And does that ruin the gameplay? Because everyone loves the dynamics. I mean, it changes the RPG factor all over.
I'm going to sort of alienate and offend a lot of people, but I don't think Final Fantasy VII's combat system would hold up today, is what I'm saying.
Other
RPGs, apart from Final Fantasy, have done a better job sort of emulating that thing. Like Child of Light does a really good sort of turn-based thing.
Do you still like turn-based?
Games have changed.
I love it
so much.
Because XCOM is like one of my favorite games. Yeah. But I think like there has to be some vast improvements to make a turn-based system interesting.
Yeah.
And I think because of the age of the game, again, don't hate me. I just think that like it's sort of had its day. I think I'm sort of glad that
Changing
going
a little
in a bit.
Different direction,
yeah.
I think
it's going to say as long as they keep cross-dressing scenes and that mission, I think we'll be fine.
Well,
this is going to be okay
to close to like the set pieces.
Oh, really?
Have you seen it yet?
I've seen it, but they didn't go that far into it.
They didn't show
someone in a dress or anything.
Oh, no. Like,
that was pretty blatantly that first mission.
Yeah.
I've seen it side by side, and it's like the same boss, it's the same environments and everything. So I think it'll still be in there.
That'd be fun.
Are you okay if they, you know, have Mickey come in like you know, like
what?
Like the thing is like they've
Are you okay with Mickey Mouse comes in?
It's like, well,
what
like
Kingdom
like
Hearts?
What I'm saying with Kingdom Hearts though, they schlock you know, Cloud into that all over the place. They schlock him into
That's Kingdom Hearts.
Nintendo.
Yeah. That's Kingdom Hearts. Slow your roll.
Why would they stick Mickey Mouse in that?
I'm just saying, like
no.
How far would you be okay with? Like, since you're okay with them changing the battle system, how far are you willing for them
Not
to go?
Not that far. You can change the battle system and still, like...
Keep the integrity of the game.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, it's still going to... It can still be what it was. You throw Mickey in there, it's fucking different, Scott. I don't know if you know that.
No, I know that. That's why I'm asking you. It's a broad point because I want you to understand, like, so how far could they go?
Can I just tell you, you've been a little Fox Newsy tonight?
Have I?
At least the last little bit.
I'm sorry, I'm going somewhere else.
You're just saying some super absurd shit. When he's like, I think that they should be more reasonable with the budget, he's like, so you don't want this animation to happen? God damn, that's not what he said at all.
I mean, I don't know. I'm not trying to drag up controversy. I just wanted to kind of find out what's happening.
Matt's swinging over here. Yeah,
Bill O'Reilly.
Sorry. Bill O'Reilly. No, then I would just be like, my opinion's the only opinion that matters ever. Not to get political.
No Mickey Mouse? No Mickey Mouse in Final Fantasy? Fucking un-American. He's un-American.
Okay.
On that note.
Yeah.
I think it looks ecstatic. Or awesome. I'm ecstatic for
He's
it.
He's ecstatic that it
I
looks
I think
awesome.
It looks ecstatic.
I think it looks amazing. I'm super excited for it.
Yeah, I think so too.
I hope to see Mickey.
I was amazed at the amount they've got done.
Yeah.
Like,
seriously. I think it's because they're building it in the 15 engine.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And
they have the groundwork laid out for them already.
Because E3 was like, here's a bit of a hint of the tip of old Cloud's sword. And I was like, well, okay, that's not really much of anything. And then all of a sudden it's like, here's the first
city.
Level. And I'm like, whoa, where'd that come from? You know?
I like the first trailer that they released, though, because of, like, the dialogue, how they're, it's basically kind of like addressing everybody. It's like, some people won't like it. You know, very vaguely it's like, but they're talking about the promise. What do you think of the voices, real quick? Because I know we got to wrap up. But what do you think of the voices?
I am not bothered. Yeah, I don't really care.
Yeah, I thought they were all right. I mean, so here's the thing: if your thoughts on it were, they're okay, that means they were good. Because if they were bad, you'd been like, oh man, that sucked. But everyone's like, I think they were all right. They were all right.
I think Barrett hits exactly what I always would when I'd read it. That's Barrett, and I know it's Jet from Cowboy Bebop.
Yeah,
but every time I'd hear Barrett's voice, like, it was that kind of voice, just this loud, obnoxious idiot, and he looks fucking cool.
Yeah,
like, I love it, dude. I'm so excited.
Cool.
Wow. There we go. All
right. Well, give us your opinions. What do you think on the trailer?
Yeah.
What did you think about Don Bluth? What do you think about Kickstarters? What do you think about any of the stuff we talked about? VR.
Yeah.
Let us know.
Gaming peripherals. What's the worst peripheral you've ever played?
Yes. Post a picture. Of
also,
I'll post my pictures.
We put together the basement. You know, man game cave.
So we will be doing a let's play downstairs, and we'll figure out how maybe to do an arcade machine let's play or a pinball machine let's play as well.
Yeah, we've been talking about it for a while, but we were really trying to get it together. So
we spent
these
6 or 8 hours Saturday doing it. So it's gonna happen.
Awesome.
Cool. And as always, YouTube, Facebook, website,
Podbean. Yep.
Instagram, Twitter, all of it.
You know where to find us.
Yep.
All right. Thanks for watching, listening.
Thank you.
Bye.
Enjoy.